Tanter Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Panzer Gunner, From My Native Canada to the German Ostfront and Back, in action with 25th Panzer Regiment, 7th Panzer Division, 1944-45, by Bruno Friesen, narrated by David DeVries. Foreword. In 1950, after my 11-year exile in Europe, I had been back in Canada for only a few weeks when Ted Nettleton, the middle-aged personnel manager at the B.F. Goodrich tire plant on King Street West in Kitchener, Ontario, mentioned to me that a certain old sea captain was known to say, "Don't tell people your troubles. Half of them don't care, and the other half are glad of them." My employment interview at Goodrich must have revealed that I was greatly concerned because a lot of my fellow citizens looked askance at me for having served in the enemy armed forces during part of the Second World War, and that I had years of catching up on formal schooling ahead of me. From 1950 to 1993, I, heeding the cautionary advice given to me by Ted Nettleton, rarely disclosed that I had been sent to Germany in 1939 and that I had been forced to live outside of Canada continuously for well over a decade. In 1994, however, with the 50th anniversary of the end of the Second World War in Europe just ahead, I decided to divulge some of my overseas experiences. I first describe in this book of mine what it was I believe that got me from Canada to Germany in 1939. I then relate how I fared in Germany before I joined the Wehrmacht on November 1, 1942. Thereupon, I present, chronologically, stories of some of my adventures as a German soldier before May 7, 1945. These chapters I regard as the book's core. Thereafter, I write about my post-war jobs in Germany and my long-delayed return to Canada. The following subsequent milestones in my life fall within the scope of the book: employment at B.F. Goodrich Canada Limited, marriage to Helga Meyer in Waterloo, Ontario in 1951, 10 years of advanced technical evening classes yielding for me ATEC Certificates 1, 2, and 3 issued by the Ontario Department of Education and registration as a certified engineering technologist, 5.5 years of full-time studies at university, resulting in the degrees of Bachelor of Arts, Master of Arts, English, and Master of Philosophy, English, 19 years of teaching English at an Ontario College of Applied Arts and Technology, retirement at age 65 in 1990, and volunteer work at the Canadian War Museum. My occasional use of German in the stories is calculated to impart to them greater realism, as well as, quite possibly, to afford the reader glimpses into the mentalities of the characters. Something purely unilingual stories based on such subject matter would do to a much lesser extent. Of course, the reader may elect to dispense with the German and rely entirely on the translations. Among my documents used, all of them uncommon, are the pocket-size one-page battle line avowal of the soldiers of the 7th Panzer Division, a document from late 1944 or early 1945, so rare that the divisional history, published in 1986, makes no mention of it. Although I have not had to rely on archival support for my stories, I have consulted the following book repeatedly: General der Panzertruppe A.D., retired, Hasso E. von Manteuffel, der 7. Panzer Division im Zweiten Weltkrieg, Einsatz und Kampf der Gespenster Division, Friedberg, Potsdam, Palace Verlag, 1986. Using only the translation of its title, henceforth I refer to the above book as the 7th Panzer Division in World War II, mostly in documenting my translations of passages from Manteuffel's original. It is not to be confused with Manteuffel's English language, the 7th Panzer Division, an illustrated history of Rommel's Ghost Division, 1938-1945. Chapter 1. Shipped Out to Germany. Thousands of times I have been asked, "What made you go back to Germany?" Thousands of times I have replied, "I didn't go back. I was born in Canada and had never been to Germany." In March 1939, 2 months before my 14th birthday, I was yanked out of Sutterby Public School on Frederick Street in Kitchener, Ontario, and together with my brother Oscar, who was 1.5 years younger than I, and 3 other youngsters from Kitchener, was put on a train to New York. There, the 5 of us boarded the express steamer Europa for the voyage to Bremerhaven in Germany. Making travel preparations for Kitchener for Oscar and I had not amounted to much more than hurriedly and quietly getting together our Canadian passports and our free tickets. That brief spell had elapsed without our being given any reason for our having to leave Canada, or for that matter, for our having to maintain silence regarding our impending departure. Often I have wanted to fathom why, surrounded by secrecy, Oscar and I were shipped out to Germany almost 70 years ago. My father, a stationary engineer at Forsyth's shirt factory in Kitchener at the time, would read well-circulated copies of various German illustrated periodicals, that I knew. He would, I also knew, drop in after work at Colerco's fruit and vegetable store near the City Hall in Kitchener, and, I suppose, have a chat with Signor Colarco about Axis developments. Yes, my father was pro-German, but I have to look far beyond Colarco's counter to explain, if I can, what it was that made him and my mother decide to send Oscar and me to Germany. Having arrived in Canada from the Ukraine in 1924, my parents, please consult the relevant maps for the location of the district in the Ukraine from which they hailed, after working for almost a year on a Pennsylvania Dutch Mennonite farm near Waterloo, Ontario, moved to the Portage-la-Prairie district of Manitoba. The Canadian Pacific Railway had advanced many Mennonite immigrants the money for their fares to Canada under the condition that they settle on lands adjacent to CPR tracks. I was born on Section 113-9 in Westbourne Municipality on May 25, 1925, and was just old enough to start school in Waterloo after my parents had abandoned their land at Westbourne and returned to Ontario. In Manitoba, they had tried in vain to farm 160 acres, part of an agriculturally inferior tract bought by 10 families while it lay under snow. Annually, widespread spring flooding prevented the timely seeding of practically all of that expanse. Among all Mennonites burdened by it, the CPR loan was referred to as our travel debt, and for them, that debt remained, for years, a financial millstone. The Great Depression, of course, was the primary cause of so much misery. It robbed my father of any hope that he might emerge debt-free in Canada. My parents had never been to Germany. Neither had my grand, great-grand, or great-great-grandparents. However, because of their first language, German, all of them had maintained strong cultural and economic ties with Germany. The German-speaking population of the Mennonite colonies in the Ukraine had for decades mail-ordered their agricultural machinery, their reading material, and starting in the early 1900s, even their automobiles from Germany. In Soviet armor ambushed at the lake at Lessen in West Prussia, one of my following stories, I refer in detail to some of my forebears' strong traditional German ties. Before we moved to Kitchener in 1937, we lived at 132 King Street South in Waterloo. Every Saturday evening, a coterie of Mennonites, including my parents, would congregate at 132. A polyglot bunch they constituted, speaking High German, Low German, Russian, Ukrainian, and some English. High German is the official language in Germany, Austria, and Switzerland. Low German, or Plattdeutsch, Platt is German for flat, is the informal German spoken in flat or lowland northern Germany. Every letter from relatives or friends in the old country that did get through to the group in those hard times was neatly written in High German, no matter how low-grade the stationery, as was every letter of response. On Saturday mornings, the WK, or Waterloo-Kitchener United Mennonite Church on George Street in Waterloo, conducted its one-room German school in the church basement. I acknowledge that during my early months in Germany, I made good use of most of the rather rudimentary German I had learned at WK. However, it turned out that the unworldliness of the school's one level of textbook, strengthened by the school's one instructor, a straight-laced lady from a fine Russian Mennonite family, had left me incapable of inquiring in refined German where the next toilet was. In 1985, about 50 years after I last attended German classes at WK, the surviving members of the family of a former custodian of the German school's textbooks presented me with the book I had used on at least one Saturday morning so very long ago. It was mine, all right, so to speak, for it bears my full name and what was then our address scribbled boyishly onto the inside of its back cover. This old book in itself attests to the Russian Mennonites' faithfulness to the German language. Its full title is Deutsches Lesebuch für Volksschulen in Russland, German Reader for Primary Schools in Russia. Published in 1919 by Gottlieb Schaab in Prischib, a town adjacent to the northwestern corner of the Molochna, one of the oldest Mennonite colonies in the Ukraine, it is one of a dozen or so identical copies that were used for years at WK, and would have been brought to Canada from Russia, probably in the early 1920s, by persons to whom the German language meant a great deal. In my own modest library, there reposes, next to the reader I have just referred to, a book entitled Poems of Nikolaus Lenau. It has an embossed spine and covers and was published in 1877 in Stuttgart in Germany. My annotation on the inside of the front cover reads as follows. Received as a gift from father at the main railway station in Wilhelmshaven before I left for Canada. This book, one of a large trunkful that my father had taken with him from the Ukraine to Canada and from Canada to Germany, signified his love of literature. I am certain that he cherished this particular book more than many of his others. Nikolaus Lenau is the pen name of Niemsch Edler von Strelenau, 1802-50. As a resident of Hungary, Lenau chose his subject matter largely from outside of Germany. It is not surprising that my father displayed a great affinity for Lenau's work. Throughout most of his adult life, my father wrote many poems and much prose, all under the pseudonym Fritz Senn. I have a 311-page book published in Winnipeg in 1987 after his death and entitled Fritz Senn, Collected Poems and Prose. Much of his writing reveals his intense nostalgia for his beloved Mennonite world in the Ukraine. My mother often related that as a single young man in the Ukraine, our paterfamilias had spent much time with his books. He was, she emphasized, the youngest of nine children in a well-to-do family, and he hadn't been expected to work hard. That, she said, had left him with a lot of time for literary studies. Probably contributing to my father's pro-German stance was the fact that, starting in 1917, he was, for a few years, a member of the Mennonite Self-Defense Organization, a paramilitary cavalry established to protect the affluent Mennonite colonies in the Ukraine from the infamous Machno's bandits. This defense organization was trained briefly by German officers and non-commissioned officers. Many purely pacifistic Mennonites condemned those of their brethren who fought the anarchistic forces. By early 1939, my father's ideas concerning emigration from Canada to Germany had become solidified, largely because of the influence of the Confederation of Germans Abroad, a Third Reich-backed propagandistic organization operating in league with many of the German social clubs in North America. At the time, the Concordia Club, the Kitchener area's largest German club, had its premises above one of the two movie theaters, either the Capitol or the Lyric, on King Street West in Kitchener. On Saturday evenings, the parents, both nominal Mennonites, of the three boys who accompanied Oscar and me to Germany, would parade most, if not all, of their 10 kids close to the dance floor at the Concordia Club. Although my parents never frequented the Concordia, our family did, in the summer of 1938, attend the club's annual picnic on cow-dung-dotted Kaufman's Flats, beside the Grand River, just upstream from Kitchener. At that picnic, my father was happy to earn a few dollars extra by washing beer glasses in the vicinity of the bar in the beer tent. The occasional glass of suds, which one of the busy, perspiring bartenders handed to him in the heat under the canvas, must have constituted his bonus. Probably the Confederation was instrumental in having the train and steamship tickets for Oscar and I paid for from within Germany. In return, The recruiters involved undoubtedly hoped that they had planted boundless love for the Third Reich in the members of our family. I believe that Fritz Sen, or if you prefer, Gerhard Johann Friesen, could not see himself as a farmer or factory worker in Canada. Germany beckoned mightily, so he sent, as the initial step in his unpublicized plan, to transplant his entire family to that promised land, his first and his second born there, albeit at a very inopportune time. My mother simply consented. Oscar and I left Kitchener for New York on March 20, 1939, and sailed from there on March 22. At any rate, we five seemingly outcast boys discovered, in one of the lounges aboard the Europa, a phonograph surmounting a boy-high cabinet of polished, reddish-brown wood filled with records. Daily throughout the crossing, we had our fun, making the thing play for hours at a time. I stress our having so much fun with the phonograph because, for us, things became absolutely mirthless upon our arrival in Bremerhaven about 1 week after we left New York. My souvenir log of that Atlantic crossing by the Europa shows that she left New York on March 22, 1939, and that she passed Cherbourg, France, and Breakwater on March 27, having covered 3,128 nautical miles in 4 days, 22 hours, and 6 minutes. For the Europa to get from Cherbourg to Bremerhaven, the souvenir log also shows that she had to travel another 535 nautical miles to get there. Must have prolonged our trip by about 2 days, making it 7 days. At this point, I had best introduce into my narrative two entire newspaper articles as well as excerpts from another two. Published in the Kitchener Daily Record between March 16 and 24, 1939, the four articles are preserved on microfilm at the archives of the Record in Kitchener, Ontario. The subject microfilm reveals its age. Nevertheless, the copies made of it on my behalf by Gerhard and Kathy Friesen reflects the concerns about Nazi activity in Canada around the time of Oscar's departure and mine. Note that the Kitchener Daily Record published our names on Friday, March 24, 1939, 2 days after the Europa had sailed from New York. Jews boycott KW product. Action said result of Nazi activity throughout district. Attorney General Conant's reported investigation into alleged Nazi activity in the Twin City and district was not in evidence here today, and both city and provincial police declined to comment on the announcement. But while there was no indication that outside police were checking on the reports, several angles came to light. It was learned that Bruno and Oscar Friesen, 821 King Street East, accompanied the four Esau children to Germany. Police keep quiet. Indications that local business might suffer from adverse publicity, given the community, came to light when the Record was informed at least one manufacturer's goods were boycotted by Toronto Jews. The latter claimed they would have nothing to do with merchandise manufactured locally. I have nothing to say for publication, Sergeant W.C. Oliver of the Provincial Police told the Record. He refused to confirm or deny a report that outside police may be sent here to probe Nazi activities. Inspector Jordan, in charge of the local detachment, was out of town and could not be reached. Chapter 2. A Stranger in Deutschland. After disembarking in Bremerhaven, we were taken to Hohenkirchen, an old village about 20 kilometers northwest of Wilhelmshaven, the naval city on the North Sea coast. The District Association of Farmers had half a dozen farmers, their large NSDAP, Nazi, membership badges in evidence. Seated at one end of the long table in the Hohenkirchen council chamber, grouped at the other end of the same table, we boys awaited our fate. How who got whom, I do not know. The farmers might as well have thrown the dice to arrive at some kind of distribution. What I do know is that I was assigned to Gerhard Eben, pronounced Eben of Karlsek, a hamlet something like 4 kilometers northwest of Hohenkirchen and within sight of the North Sea dike. Promptly, the stern-faced lady of the Ebenhaus, bent on finding out how much German I knew not, asked me to read the name of their weekly newspaper. Because the J and the F in Gothic type look very much alike, I read aloud, Pfeffisches Wochenblatt. I should have read Jefisches Wochenblatt. At that, the entire family guffawed. Present were the Ebens' two daughters, both of whom attended high school in Jever, the district capital 16 kilometers west-northwest of Wilhelmshaven. A day or two after my arrival in Karlsek, I was handed an oversized Piesava broom and told to remove the thick moss covering an entire wall of one of the brick buildings. As I attacked the moss, a couple of middle-aged sightseers with horse and buggy drove up. Reins in hand, the nosy rustic said to his equally nosy wife, "Dat is Gerd's in Americana." That is Gerhard's American. In addition to sounding a lot like a reference to my being regarded as the Eben's chattel, those words showed the locals' ignorance of the existence of Canada. Every visitor who came to the Ebens specifically to behold the Americana had to agree with the master of the house's pronouncement that Germany had saved a young lad of German blood from degenerate life in America. What could I say? Had my parents not sent me to Deutschland? Up Jever, near Jever, at the time had a military airfield which still exists for the Bundeswehr, successor to the Wehrmacht. In 1939, planes from Upjever sometimes practiced low-level flying over the fields at places like Karlsek, just about scaring the yokels on the ground into deep, water-filled ditches. When there was once talk at the table of half the tribe having been buzzed by two flying machines stationed at Upjever, I mentioned that in Canada, we boys had fashioned model aircraft from balsa wood, using twisted rubber bands as motive power for their propellers. Impossible! The Ebens and whoever else was there blurted out. I should, they scolded, stick to the truth and not talk about planes in America. Instead, I should talk about the planes at Upjever, real, live German military aircraft. In every respect, Deutschland, Deutschland above all else governed the thinking of the ignorant, humiliating bastards that the word Karlsek stood for. Less than half a year later, I was no longer confined to performing tasks like trying to rid a brick wall of stubborn, centimeter-thick moss. During harvest time in 1939, for instance, I carried many sacks full of heavy grain from the threshing machine, up a ladder, not up any stairs, and into the granary, actually the attic above the family's living quarters. I served as the family's underprivileged junior hired man. Their senior hired man, a good enough chap by the name of Gerd Brandt, volunteered for the German infantry to get away from Karlsek. My room was what is called an aftermost, or back kitchen, a small place adjacent to the upper end of the long cattle stable. I say upper end because the stable was built on a slight incline to facilitate partial drainage toward its lower end, one of the excrement gutters situated immediately behind the rows of cattle. Crudely fashioned, by means of four thumbtacks to the inside of the gray wooden door of my uncomfortable abode, hung a magazine clipping showing the black-and-white copy of a portrait of Adolf, and, in the margin below, his likeness, his telling signature consisting of a snippet of Adolf, followed by a downsloping, tornado-like vortex representing Hitler. My wash water I usually fetched, at least in the frost-free months of the year, a pail full at a time from the frog-infested, moat-like ditch almost surrounding the farm's clustered buildings. Home, sweet home. Once every week, I was a foreigner living in what was called a border area. I had to walk to the police station in Hohenkirchen, report to the police, and walk back to the farm. If I was lucky, I would meet one or two of the Canadians at or near the police station. They, too, had to show up there in person. Upon returning to the farm at Karlsek, I would, without fail, be quizzed about what I had observed along the way. How is so-and-so's oats coming along, and how many head of cattle are grazing on his land? Gone for good, I knew, was the old neighborhood gang back in Canada. Gone were the roller skates in summer. Gone was the Albert Street Hill in Kitchener, Our ski and toboggan hill with the synagogue and the city's water tower at its apex, and Rumpel's bush at the bottom of its eastern slope. Gone was so much. Gone abruptly was my childhood. Surprise! A few weeks before the outbreak of Second World War, my parents, with the rest of their kids, three of them, all Canadian-born, made it to Germany, to Wilhelmshaven, to be exact. The apartment assigned to them was on the ground floor of a First World War-era walk-up on Kasernenstrasse, a short street with Ruhnstrasse and its immense Kriegsmarine barracks opposite its one end, and the high, barbed-wire-topped brick wall of the submarine base opposite its other. Half a dozen blocks north of Kasernenstrasse towered one of the city's landmarks, the Kaiser Wilhelm Bridge, also called KW Brücke, with the KW as in Kitchener-Waterloo. Still in operation, this old swing bridge connects the city with the commercial beach, the location of, for instance, the Seawater Aquarium. In the walk-up, the toilets, not the bathrooms, because there weren't any, for all of the apartments were off the stairway landings between the floors. Not only that, next to each toilet door was the coin-operated gas meter for the corresponding apartment. One had to feed one's meter frequently and on time, or it would, without warning, shut off the gas. On the far side of Kasernenstrasse, Emmy Zeile, a spinster, operated a small grocery store. Emmy wanted the new family on the street to have a treat, so she sold my mother some Roquefort. Not knowing that Roquefort contained veins of mold, my father thought that the cheese was spoiled. He exclaimed, "Die meint wohl wir essen im Dunkeln." She must think that we eat in the dark. Their table in Canada, and before that in the Ukraine, had hardly seen the delicacies that were common in Western Europe. We, my parents included, were learning many things daily. My father was soon introduced by the NSDAP, Nationalsozialistische Deutsche Arbeiterpartei, or Nazi Party, to his first German place of employment, an electrical business owned by Julius Harms, a master electrician and politically well-connected bigwig, whose wife Amanda had, I later learned, been a cocktail hostess in her younger years. Julius's business premises were located on Marktstrasse, in the heart of Wilhelmshaven. The new employee at Harms' little empire was known as the store's administrator. Rolls, large and small, of various gauges of electrical wire, untold numbers of diverse fasteners, ladders of different length, special tools, that sort of treasure my father administered. When the old man, that's a term we boys had often used in Canada, visited me at Karlsek, his jaw dropped. He soon took the train back to Wilhelmshaven and enlisted the help of the city's political boss, Kreisleiter, district political leader Meyer, to secure my release from the Ebens. Meyer, who seemed to be endowed with humanitarian qualities, promised to have the old man's two boys join the family in Wilhelmshaven. Oscar was in servitude on a farm at Carolinensiel, down the North Sea coast, just west of Hohenkirchen. In the tightly organized NSDAP, every Kreisleiter, subordinate to his Gauleiter, political leader of a province, was in charge of the following classes of functionaries: Ortsgruppenleiter, political leader of a ward in a city or of a county; Zellenleiter, political leader of a part of a city ward or county; and Blockleiter, political warden of a block. Blockleiter abounded in a large city like Wilhelmshaven. Even Kreisleiter Meyer was unable to take me away from Karlsek without coming up with a very good reason for my switch from the country to the city. The solution? A genuine, old-fashioned apprenticeship for me. Still, it took another 6 months before I had Julius Harms as my master, or before he had me as one of his three apprentices, learning the trade of electrician. Once again, I had no say in what was happening to me. Suddenly, I had an indenture binding me to 3 years, from April 26, 1940, to April 25, 1943, of good behavior, hard work, regular attendance of the trade school, and barely any pay. During the first year, 3 Reichsmark per week. During the second year, 4 Reichsmark per week. And during the third year, 5 Reichsmark per week. Figuratively speaking, 1 Reichsmark equaled $1 at the time. Payday was each Saturday. After the driveway, the yard, and the warehouse at Marktstrasse 39 had been swept clean by noon. The stipulation that I attend Hitler Youth Service as part of my apprenticeship appeared in typing under the printed heading Besondere Bestimmungen, Special Conditions, on the last of the four legal-sized pages that constituted my indenture. The apprentice must attend Hitler Youth Service regularly. Contrary to expectations, the one man in the company who had the most authority to pressure us apprentices politically did no such thing. Consequently, neither did anyone else. Our savior was Karl Pott, whose last name rhymed with boat. A master electrician and Julius Harms's right-hand man, Karl had served as a petty officer in the Kaiser's Navy in World War I, about a quarter of a century before I got to know him. Karl trusted his people, and they trusted him. He once told me that Hitler Youth Service amounted to hocus-pocus. That sort of talk could have put him into a concentration camp. It was hard to believe that his son had a full-time position at the Hitler Jugend headquarters in Wilhelmshaven. On the job, an apprentice could frequently tear his clothing. The quick fix for any tear, especially a large one, was to stitch it with bare copper wire of a small gauge. Towards the end of the week, one's work outfit would look a bit tattered, just as mine did one day when I met Amanda in the vicinity of the Marktstrasse. Sizing me up soon after I had been spotted by Amanda, Karl said, "You look pretty shabby." He was right. However, he didn't leave things at that. A few days later, he presented me with a ration coupon for new work pants and jacket. He had rapport with his subordinates, especially with the apprentices. Old Karl, a serious-looking little guy, liked to keep a cigar going, at least intermittently, when he made his rounds of the job sites. My father hadn't worked for Julius very long before Kreisleiter Meyer found a position for him as cashier's bookkeeper at the income tax office in Wilhelmshaven. To get to know the fiscal ropes, he had to take an extensive course at the School of Finance in Flensburg, up near the German-Danish border. By that time, my parents had realized what life in an overpopulated country at war was and would continue to be like. My father must have voiced his disillusionment, because on one occasion, Kreisleiter Meyer rebuked him by saying, "Do get rid of your Canadian attitude." Julius's electrical firm had a great many government contracts for work at the naval dockyards in Wilhelmshaven. I spent weeks at a time learning from well-versed journeymen and even young masters of the trade how to install electrical wiring by the mile, by the kilometer, really, in various huge buildings such as the machine construction building number 3, while moving about on scaffolding as high as a tall ship's rigging. Expressed in one German novel of the sea, an old sailor's advice to a novice crewman aboard a sailing ship goes as follows: one hand for the ship, the other hand for yourself. That line applied to anyone engaged in the kind of electrical work we did at hazardous heights. My getting around in the naval dockyards made me aware of great weaknesses in the country's security. For instance, one day in 1940, a friendly and enthusiastic teenage dockyard worker offered to show me aboard Germany's largest battleship, the Tirpitz, which lay alongside an outfitting pier. The ship, to which the following dates would apply, was fast taking shape in the presence of the proud dockyard workers. Laid down October 20, 1936, launched April 1, 1939, and completed February 25, 1941. At the shoreward end of the long gangplank leading to an open area on the ship's weather deck, a young Kriegsmarine sentry had his post. Dockyard workers, many of them carrying toolboxes, streamed past him on their way to the giant's innards. To walk onto that ship, I simply mingled with the many workers, who bore neither name tags nor passes. Their work clothes were the standard blue pants and jacket, just like mine. Below deck, wherever my guide and I went, and that was a total of only a few hundred meters, the danger of our being found out and apprehended increased tenfold. Nowhere did we linger, for every tradesman, for instance, and his helpers could readily tell that we bareheaded youths were in no position to ply any trade. Besides, tradespeople habitually made it a point to become acquainted very quickly with persons from other trades who worked in their proximity, just as my dockyard pal and I had gotten to know each other on the job. Consequently, like a pair of young, new-in-town vagrants sizing up a succession of alleys unfamiliar to them, he and I moved warily through some of the Tirpitz's steely passages before we headed back towards the gangplank traffic. Had I been arrested aboard the Tirpitz or in her vicinity, I would, fortunately, have been dealt with fairly leniently as a 15-year-old young offender. Yes, I paid the Tirpitz a hurried visit about 4 years and 3 months before. On November 12, 1944, several British tallboy bombs caused her to capsize with the loss of some 1,200 lives at Tromsø, near the northern end of Norway's long Atlantic coast. Across the Kaiser Wilhelm Bridge in Wilhelmshaven and down to the right, close to the base of the huge dike between a kind of minor coastal road and the tideland, the Kriegsmarine had built a new cartography building. The inside of the place wasn't entirely finished. Sections of it needed good-quality electric lighting, and that was where we fellows from Lighting House Harms came in. The cartography building housed thousands of naval charts that were entrusted to a team of cartographers, every one of whom was exempt from military service because of his advanced age. A particularly talkative chartist, who had lived in England, liked to have his colleagues call him Huey. The cartography building's hydrographic charts, domestic and foreign, were all classified as secret. Yet we chaps from Harms handled dozens of them at our leisure, another soft spot in Germany's security. Trade school meant half a day a week away from work. NSDAP protocol demanded that at the beginning of each such half day in class, one of the students had to march to the front of the room, turn about and holler, while extending his right arm straight forward so that his outstretched right hand was at the level of his right eye. We begin our instruction with a threefold greeting to our Führer. Sieg Heil, hail to victory. Sieg Heil, Sieg Heil. Next, the cheerleader would do his best to enunciate loudly some NSDAP maxim. Work ennobles was a favorite with the apprentices because of its brevity. Another acceptable utterance, also not hard to recall, was rather be the hammer than the anvil. For a while, before I would be it up front, I listened around, and from a young fellow who, with his parents, had come to Wilhelmshaven from the coal scuttle, the coal-rich part of the Ruhr Valley, I got a non-political saying that I actually used. I simply recited, loudly and clearly, "Whoever hooks cabbage in the summer has sauerkraut in the winter." I got away with it. The instructor and the rest of the class may have thought that I hadn't been in Germany long enough to come out with something befitting the occasion. By 1941, our family resided in Fedavadagroden, a west end suburb of Wilhelmshaven. The place was nicknamed Rabbit Housing because its many row houses were reminiscent of long lines of pens for domestic rabbits. In Fedavadagroden, as in the city, insufficient food ration stamps were symbolic of near breadless days and luminous pin-on badges of gloomy nights. Contributing almost daily and certainly almost nightly to the miserable living conditions in and around Wilhelmshaven were the Allied air raids that drove mainly the young and the old into the various kinds of air raid shelters for hours at a time. Unlike the core areas of the larger city, such as Wilhelmshaven, its suburbs had no 30-meter-high, cylindrical, above-ground air raid shelters with meter-thick concrete walls and slightly conical, thick concrete tops. The interior of each such shelter consisted of a concrete ramp spiraling upward with no steps whatsoever, about a central concrete column. A couple of meters away from the column stood the rows of wooden benches fixed radically to the ramp. The basement air raid shelters in the houses in a new suburb like Fedavadagroden, the place had been built just before the Second World War, had, I would say, been designed in anticipation of war and bombing raids. The extra-thick laminated wood doors and window shutters and the frames for them, as well as the sturdy hardware, were all part of the building's original construction. Nothing makeshift. Whereas Wilhelmshaven Center, including its naval yards, attracted many big, high-explosive bombs and incendiary bombs, Fedavadagroden would usually be hit with only the small, hexagonal incendiaries, each some 45 centimeters long. Often they rained down seven to a bundle, six outer bombs strapped to one central bomb. Halfway through 1941, my father, then 47, was, without notice, called up for service in the Army as a special duties officer with the rank of corporal. Generally, a special duties officer would function as an interpreter, translator. My father had grown up in the Ukraine. He had lived there from his birth in 1894 until 1924, that is, for 30 years. He certainly knew Ukrainian and Russian. About 18 years after he and my mother had emigrated from the Ukraine, my father experienced what was probably one of the highlights of his life. He was, in the Ukraine, able to visit Hauptstadt, his birthplace, and other places he knew from his youth. However, he certainly had to pay an exorbitant price for the thrill. Late in the summer of 1942, about 2.5 years after I had begun my apprenticeship, I had to appear at a registration for the military draft, including physical examination and tentative classification. 50 unclothed young men hung around inside a pub, each waiting to take his turn at standing at attention inside the white circle drawn with chalk on the hardwood floor of the bowling alley, part of the premises. 5 meters from the chalk circle, 3 military officers seated at a long table decided, mainly by just looking at the individual nudes before them, what branch of the Wehrmacht Adonis would be suitable for. In reality, they looked primarily for replacements for the branches of the Wehrmacht that had suffered the greatest losses. The infantry was a sure bet. I had heard that in the cities, especially, such a triumvirate liked to earmark the mechanical and electrical tradesmen for the armored troops. My qualifications, sparse as they were, counted, and I was told that I would be hearing from a Panzer Personnel Replacement Battalion. The entire registration process had an archaic, none too rigorous and even comical air about it. As well as suffering other minor indignities, such as being ordered to look alive, every guy being screened in the chalk circle had to about-face on command, bend forward, and expose to the officers his anus by manually spreading his buttocks. At that stage of the Musterung, spotting piles was what the officers were concerned with, 'twas said. I don't recall the German name of that pub in Wilhelmshaven, but I do know that some 2¾ years later, it was known as the Starboard Light, operated for members of the British element of the CCG, the Control Commission for Germany. In early October of 1942, I had my enlistment order telling me to appear on November 1, 1942, at the Panzer Personnel Replacement Battalion 10 in Großklinike, just west of Berlin, out Potsdam way. At this point, I have to say that on August 17, 1943, I passed the final examination for my journeyman certificate as an electrician. I had obtained a short leave of absence and showed up in uniform at the trade school. Because I was serving in the Wehrmacht, I was credited with 1/2 year of school and practical experience, meaning the time from November 1, 1942 to April 25, 1943. It was called, granted, 1/2 year. Chapter 3. The first 6 months of my military service. By the very beginning of November 1942, the barracks of the Replacement Battalion 10 in Großklinike were overcrowded to the extent that new recruits had to be put up in the large panzer garages behind the barracks blocks. Although the unit had no panzers, the relatively new barracks had been provided with garages. Each morning, for a couple of weeks, many recruits, picked at random, were ordered to do lots of push-ups in the urine-soaked areas next to the garage doors, where dozens of men had relieved themselves the night before. For the first few days, before the recruits were issued their field gray uniform, they had to do the push-ups while still wearing their civilian clothing. Each recruit at the Replacement Battalion 10 eventually got his paybook. He also got his oval identification disc of rust-proof metal, with 3 elongated breakaway perforations at its longer axis. Each half of the disc showed 3 items of information: his blood group, his original military unit, Stamm Company or Cadre Company, and his enrollment number in that unit. My disc, which I still have, reads as follows: O, Stamm Kop, Pitz Erz Abt 10, 862. The 0.5 millimeter thick disc's axes measure 7 centimeters and 5 centimeters. The noiseless disc, hung from around one's neck by means of a sweatproof shoelace-like cord, looped through two holes close to the outer edge of its upper half. The lower half, to be retrieved in the event of one's demise, had but one hole close to its outer edge. The replacement battalion's garages stood close to one side of the paved parade square, at whose very center towered a steel flagpole from which the Reich's flag flew. It was on that damned square, daily the scene of much real tragicomedy, which the recruits had to assemble to swear the oath of allegiance. On the day of the swearing-in ceremony, 4 25-ton Panzer IVs, brought in from some other panzer unit in Berlin, were positioned, one at each corner of the square, with their frontal armor directed towards the flagpole and with their main guns at maximum elevation, as if mimicking the German greeting or Nazi salute. Each of the four guns looked as though it were aimed inadvertently at the flag, directly below which, in the presence of the top brass, stood on parade a dozen recruits who had been picked to represent their comrades, all of whom stood at attention on the square well away from the flagpole. Those 12 reps would have to echo on behalf of their buddies the stern words of the far-reaching oath. The proxies at the flagpole obediently repeated in bits, as administered, the words of the oath, which in its entirety ran as follows. I swear by God this holy oath that I will render to the Führer of the German Reich and the German people, Adolf Hitler, the supreme commander of the Wehrmacht, unconditional obedience, and that I will, as a brave soldier, at all times, be prepared to give my life for this oath. For sure, seeing themselves sworn in by proxy constituted a singular experience for most of the men. The field gray uniform each of us recruits in Großklinika was given didn't include an overcoat, probably because generally we stayed warm by moving fast while out in the open. During the breaks, however, we felt the biting cold. In the Berlin area, the minimum outside temperature averages close to 0 degrees centigrade for most of November and December. Outside on many a cold day, each of us occasionally warmed at least his gloveless, numb hands by backhandedly swatting for a while the fingers of one hand, then of the other, against the trouser-clad backside of a buddy bent over forwards. Since this peculiar practice, which entailed reciprocity, was performed in response to an NCO's order, it seemed to be based on German military tradition. At Großklinika, every day was filled with activities, many of them unscheduled, designed to instill utter obedience in a recruit. Having lain packed all night long in a barracks room originally meant for a third of that number of men, 18 guys, upon hearing the NCO of the day holler, "Get up!" and blow his sports whistle out in the hallway, ran for the washroom. There, at least one NCO lurked, fully expecting to catch men turning on the water taps while still wearing their undershirts. "You dirty pig, you!" he would holler at any culprit who, without bare upper body, as much as looked at any of the taps. Any sign of moisture at the neck of one's undershirt brought on a tirade. "You soft cock, you sissy, you masturbator, get out of that shirt!" After being subjected to such abuse, or after having witnessed it, the recruit did not hurry to a dining room for a hearty breakfast. No, sir. He returned to his still unventilated room and cut a slice off what was left of his one-third of a takeout loaf of army bread, bread that was to last him for several days. If he had no more margarine, ersatz honey, or rubbery sausage, he simply resorted to plain bread with thumb and index finger as the spread. A mess tin lid full of lukewarm Negerschweiß, literally black man sweat, but meaning coffee, a man could get at the quartermaster's window, that dimly lit hole in the wall with a half-height door down at the end of the hall. The small rations prompted the saying, "The quartermaster has cut his finger," meaning that he, in preparing small portions, had cut his finger. Keeping rations in one's locker was sanctioned, as long as, for instance, no unclean knife blade or crumbs were in evidence there. Theft of rations, or of anything else, if resulting from a locker left unlocked, could lead to the victim being charged with inducing a comrade to commit theft. The next part of the day's activity began with assembly on the parade square. There, too, some of the NCOs would be bent on catching more shitbirds, meaning filthy persons, by shining rundown flashlights, the flat, button-on German military jobs with a blackout cover, into the ears of the recruits. They also checked the men's hands, especially the fingernails, for cleanliness. Allowing the NCOs to gloat over the men's discomfort, at least temporarily, the sergeant major took over. His goddamn report book had its place in an unbuttoned gap in the front of his jacket. Get your name in that black-covered book, and you'd do extra duty somewhere, somehow, that very day. The sergeant major wouldn't necessarily immediately use the abusive language characteristic of the rest of the unit's NCOs, although he was a master at it. After several tries at assembling, with special attention to toe the line, no toes of boots were ever shiny enough or lined up straight enough right away, and at ease, as well as a thorough roll call, the men soon marched off. Whoever hadn't eaten well, and who had, hardly felt like launching into some ditty about girls. Nevertheless, that was the way to go. Hours of left wheel and right wheel and the like, followed by an hour or so of calisthenics, loosened the men up for the day. Every inch of the way, the NCOs looked for trouble. A guy poorly standing at attention was called a excrement, voided as a turd, roughly the shape of a question mark, or a cockeyed fuck-up, and was ordered, pinch your buttocks together, and take the slack out of your skeleton. The soldier's midday meal did not come from his small hoard of victuals in his locker. Rather, a kitchen bull or cook slapped the man's mess tin about half full of food at food issue at the barracks kitchen. Sometimes the noonday meal consisted of a hodgepodge, such as bean soup with meat added or pea soup with bacon. Often quoted, the following saying applied to both of these soups. Every little bean causes a faint sound, every pea a bang. The trouble with those soups, which usually amounted to mush because they had been stirred excessively, was that the soldier wasn't certain about their meat content. With some foods, such as fried potatoes with small sausages, the man could easily see what he was getting in the way of meat. The 1941 Army Service Manual No. 86, entitled Field Cookbook, page 43, contains the following passage pertaining to the serving of meat. Prior to issuing food, divide the meat into portions. The soldier wants to see his portion of meat. Therefore, if possible, the meat must not be cut small and mixed into the food, or even be present only in the form of fibers in the food. The same source, page 107, under the heading 10 Commandments for the Field Cook, emphatically reiterates part of page 47. Last, cut meat into portions on meat cutting board, keep portions warm inside food-carrying containers, and serve individually. Reason? The soldier wants to see meat. Although they had to observe strict rationing, they never handed out seconds. The cooks, not the quartermaster, dispensed the kind of food that sustained the recruits at Großklinike. The HDV-86, of which I have a photocopy, also bears the following two imprints on its front cover as well as on its title page, MDV-NR-894 and LDV-86. The manual was, therefore, valid not only for the Heer, but also for the Kriegsmarine and the Luftwaffe. It was published August 16, 1941, by the High Command of the Wehrmacht. After the short noon break, the soldiers at the replacement battalion usually spent the rest of the afternoon outside. Often they marched to the shooting range for shooting instructions and shooting practice. Owing to their infantry-oriented basic training, which included field stripping and reassembling the German foot soldiers' primary weapons in total darkness, all of the recruits visiting the range understood the machine gun model 1934, the Mauser carbine 98K, and both 9mm pistols, namely the Luger and the P-38. When field stripping any of these firearms, a man had to put the small parts into his overturned field cap to keep them from getting lost. Since the parts were oily, the lining of the cap especially became spotted and required washing with soap and water. The inside of one's cap and the white side of one's collar band, buttoned to the inside of the collar of the field gray uniform jacket, were always the first items of clothing to be inspected by the NCOs. Most potato peelers and toilet cleaners in the barracks had been caught with duds with bacon fat on them, duds spotted with body oil, and, in the case of the field caps, with firearms oil. Failing, supposedly, to salute properly, here, there, and everywhere, caused no end of headaches for the recruit. However, at the shooting range, a man could be crapped upon or snarled at, both forms of dressing down, for saluting a superior. Throughout the Wehrmacht, saluting was forbidden at firing ranges or inside washrooms, especially if the latter included toilets. Still, the NCOs played hell with the men at the range. "Don't make your right eye squint into the left pocket of your jacket," and "quit trembling as though you're..."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.